All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat 503. Thank you guys very much for watching. First time, long time. Either way, I appreciate it. Coming live from Portland, Oregon, trying to break it all down on the West Coast. Today is Friday, August 5th. Camp has opened for Oregon football. Woo, baby! Oh, man, we've been waiting for this day, have we not? Holy smokes. We all love football, and we all got to give a shout-out to football. But really quickly, first and foremost, I got to give some shouts out here first. Lost an absolute icon, Bill Russell. I'm a big jersey guy. This one is one of my absolute favorites, the shooting shirt. The Bill Russell, dude. Absolute icon. I mean, dude, most championships of anybody in the NBA. Guy, first black head coach, won championships in college at San Francisco. I mean, West Coast legend. Dude, Bill Russell. Advocate, civil rights advocate, everything else, man. Shouts out to Bill Russell, absolute legend. One of my childhood heroes. As a kid growing up, I loved East Coast basketball, the Celtics and everything, and of course, he's the guy. And then Vin Scully passed away. The greatest announcer of my era, hands down, in my opinion. I'm a big baseball guy. I love baseball on the radio. And Vin Scully, man, always, every time I think about Vin, I always think of, get your Farmer John hot dog, Farmer John. Man, the Dodger dogs, man, Dodger Stadium. We had actually Vin broadcast here for about 5 years in Portland. I listened to it all the time. And Charlie Steiner, another one of my favorites down there, ESPN, one of the old ESPN guys, Dodger broadcaster, had some great things to say about Vin, but lost two icons. So there you go. Boom. Let's get that out of the way. Give shouts out. Rest in peace to Bill Russell and to Vin Scully. All right. Let's talk about Oregon Ducks, people. This is what we're here for. Let's go. Camp opens up, and, you know, everything's exciting about camp. You get the two deep. You know, James Crepia, shouts out to James. He jumped on it right out of the gate. Has his starting two deep, three deep, whatever you want to call it. And, you know, there's some surprises, you know. Where are you going to put Sean Dollars? You know, you have some guys who you expect to be in some places, and you with transfers and everything else, you know, maybe they're not in the same spot you thought they were going to be, which is, it happens, right? Big news today that the color schedule came out, and I don't know who all on this channel goes to Autzen Stadium or maybe goes to a Duck event on the road or maybe somewhere else in a different town where that people wear their gear or whatever else like that, which I think would be great. But, you know, when you look at the idea of what we have here and you get to the, you know, the color schedule, I don't know if everybody follows the color schedule the way that, you know, sometimes I do, sometimes I don't, you know, depends on how it is. You know, the color schedule to me is not like I have to wear green if it's green, you know, there's some games where I might not, but right out of the gate, you've got green, you've got black the first, second week, but you got the pink, which is always great. You know, you got the two road games, you're wearing white, that's fine. But Matrell McGraw, a little insider information, Matt McGraw, who works for Nike, said watch out for the first game at Georgia and keep your eyes on the Utah game at the end of the year. Now, what I was immediately talking with my son about would immediately talk about jerseys, right? And what would the retro jersey be that we'd want to see retroed? I think it's about time we retro the Joey Harrington era jersey. I would love to see the Dennis Dixon era jersey with the diamond plate on the shoulder pads. But I'm a big believer in that Joey Harrington era, that first O, Mallard helmets, the whole thing. That would be an awesome one to see. And retro it, put out the jerseys, let people buy it, everything else. But I'm expecting something new this year as well, and something maybe different. So keep your eye out for that Georgia week and for the Utah week. That's from Matrell. That's what he said. But the pink is going to be interesting. I don't know how pink they go with it, but you know it'd be fun to see the pink come back. I always like to rock the pink on the pink night. Breast cancer. Has cost the lives of people in my family. My aunt, rest in peace. My mom beat breast cancer as well. And so, you know, you got to believe that there's some positivity there. But that UCLA game is a tough game. It's going to be a wild one. Pink on one side, baby blue on the other. that'll be a wild game to watch. But let's talk about the practice, okay? First practice is in the gate. And, you know, you had the excitement of this team, right? You have a brand new coaching staff. We've talked about this ad nauseum now, and now's the time we actually get to see it. So what do you see, right? Well, you see pretty much what you thought you'd see, but you also maybe have some question marks. Dan Lanning said it was not great. He said he couldn't play the game tomorrow. That's luckily why it's in a month away. But, you know, first is always fun. You got to break the cobwebs off a lot. These guys have been working. A lot of these guys have been putting in hours. They're ready to go. He said they're fast. But by, you know, period eight, they were already slowed down. They look strong. I think the offseason conditioning was awesome. Wilson Love did a great job. And the whole staff. You know, I tend to think that that's the most important part of the whole calendar year for a college football player is the offseason after the bowl game, before fall camp, when you really get to focus on yourself, your body, your nutrition, your X's and O's in your own classroom, work with guys, get your transition right, and really focus on your craft. You know, as a basketball player growing up, they always talked about the basketball guys would come back with something added to their game, right? Every summer they'd come back something new to their game. Well, you can't always do that for a football player, but you can at least add something, whether it's speed, whether it's strength, whether it's flexibility, agility, whatever the case may be. This is a team that's healthy. There's a lot of guys that are coming off injuries, guys like Patrick Herbert that are coming back at full strength, ready to go. And it's going to be fun to see some of these guys play who we haven't really seen play. I mean, obviously, everybody's focused on Justin Flo. Justin Flo, in my mind, is the number one intriguing player on this team. You know what Noah Sewell's going to bring. You know his energy. You know his importance to the defense. And you know his acumen X's and O's. This guy is one of the most intelligent football players I've ever seen. This is a great player. He worked a lot on his coverage and how to kind of assess where to be on the field to be able to maximize for his efficiency. But, you know, Justin Flo coming off of the injury that he had, being able to be cleared at that very last part for the spring, you know, I think there's a lot of stuff for him that he had to work through. And his interview at Media Day was phenomenal. If you have not seen him, I am a huge believer in this guy. We call him Apex Predator. This is a guy who is absolutely dialed in at his position and could really, really help out the middle of that defense. We know what you're going to get with the middle of the defense with this team. You've got some great linebackers, and you've got depth in the linebacker core. But what you need next is you need to have some consistency. You need to have the ability to stay on the field and be healthy. And again, the injuries are not a person's fault. It's not his fault that he got injured twice. But people are going to look at that and say, hey, can the guy stay healthy? Is there something else the matter? And I'm a big believer that there's nothing else to matter. The fact is, injuries happen. And sometimes the return on investment after an injury is actually greater than you possibly could have had before the injury, because you have to take some time off. You have to get mental about it. You have to go through your rehab. You learn a lot about yourself. And I've had a lot of guys on here talking about in the past how the injury and the recovery in the injury really helped them grow as a football player and as a man. They learn things about themselves individually, and they learn that it can be all taken away from them in one play. And the preciousness of this game, the sanctity of this game, is all about injury and staying healthy. What do they say in the NFL? Your biggest ability is your availability. So the ideology is the most important thing you can do is be healthy and be on the field and be ready to produce. Now, obviously, after the first day of camp, you're already going to see some injuries. Nothing was reported today, but you're going to see some guys that are going to start feeling it. Once they start throwing pads on, once they start doing other sort of stuff, where they start hitting and everything else, you're going to see some guys go down. We see it every year, non-contact injury in the fall camp. Guys cutting on the turf and his knee blows out. It's going to happen. It's a contact sport and injuries are part of the game. So you got to be able to roll with it. Last year, the injury bug hit so hard that it was like comical at certain points. Like, are you kidding me? Seriously? Another one in this position? Another one? This year, hopefully, turn the tide. and get some guys healthy for the whole year. Hopefully, this is a year where you really get to see some guys flourish. So, guys who I'm looking forward to seeing, guys who I think are going to be some serious impact players, Seven McGee. I can't wait to watch Seven this year. If they give him the ball and they give him the ball in space, this guy's an athlete. He's going to make things happen. Obviously, defensively, everybody's after Justin Flo. I think he's going to be amazing. The guy who I'm excited to watch is DJ Johnson. I think DJ Johnson is primed for a heck of a year this year, and I think he's going to do it in a variety of ways. They're going to put a lot of pressure on the offenses using these guys on defense. The talent on the defense is so good this year, they're going to have to put a lot of pressure on them. So, all right, guys. Continue to get on here. I'll start to have people on. I'll start to have media guys in here and media gals in here trying to talk about what they see in camp. You know, I'm in Portland. I'll be going to the beach. Still got some weeks of the summer to enjoy here. It's a great time to be alive if you're a Duck fan. So continue to watch here. Look over at the other guys' channels. Max Torres, got to check him out. You got to check out my buddy Spencer McLaughlin. I just got off with Spencer. Locked On Ducks, Locked On Podcast, Locked On Pac-12 Podcast. You got to check out Zach Neal, USA Today. You got to check out Tyson Alger, I-5 Corridor. I mean, these are some guys. Obviously, everybody who probably should be checking out to begin with, Rob Mosley. Rob's the guy. He's the GOAT. But then Matt Preem, Eric Scopel, Jared Mack, all those guys, 247. There's so many guys doing so many things out there. Check them out. Be a fan of the Ducks. Go embrace this stuff. All right, guys. Thanks for watching Sports Chat 503. We'll see you next time. Adios.